Namaste and a very warm welcome to all on behalf of HR Milestone. We feel delighted to bring to you a life-touching session on celebrating GPS of life, a Guru Purnima special session. We all use a GPS system in our phones while we travel. It gives us a sense of assurance, a feeling of security that once we start the navigation, we would be safely guided to our destination. Similarly, today we are here to have an insightful learning about the GPS of our lives, our gurus, mentors, coaches, who can be in the form of our teachers, friends, strangers, relatives, subordinates, etc., who have guided us and touched our lives in one or the other way. At times, it has been the hand-holding. At times, we were encouraged to embark upon our endeavors alone. Everything helped in our involvement as person. Let me talk something about HR Milestone Forum, which believes in network for net worth. It's a very dynamic and an engaging HR forum, which was initiated almost a decade ago by Mr. Harish Chaturvedi and his team. Its vision is to become the leading HR community focused on learning and development of HR fraternity. Now, how do we do this? It is by bringing together the industry leaders, academia, budding professionals, veterans, and others on a single common platform for healthy exchange of knowledge, experience, and wisdom so that we can achieve our potential, drive the organizational performance, and advance our profession. The motive of this forum is very clearly visible in its logo. If we pay attention to the H in the HR Milestone, we can see there are two people shaking hands. This signifies that the platform is for professionals to interact and network and enrich each other. You can also see a necktie that represents development through knowledge and making budding professionals corporate ready. The third point is the downward arrow, which indicates downloading knowledge to the next generation. This is to strengthen the industry-academia interface. We're very happy to share that we have more than 3,500 members across the nation and counting. We are present on social media through multiple platforms, nearly 1,500 members on our Telegram, Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn. We have nearly 14 plus WhatsApp groups where we stay connected. Words would fall short when I try to introduce our eminent speaker of the day, Ms. Harini Srinivasan. Ms. Harini is a partner at Semco Style Institute India LLP, a business transformation evangelist, a design thinker, a neuroscience enthusiast, and behavioral scientist, adept in unlocking human potential in organizations. More than two decades of successful experiments in the areas of leveraging people potential for business agility and excellence. She is a versatile personality, a maverick, a dancer, a painter, a storyteller, TEDx speaker. She spreads her wisdom on various digital platforms through her hashtag HSExpress. As learned from her mentees, she is a guru, a mentor, a counselor, a guide, a friend, and a lot more, who serves as a mirror and helps you reflect yourself. We also have her fan page on Facebook, where we can get to know many interesting insights about her as an individual. She is a mentor who says, "I'm always there," and literally she is. Just a phone call or a WhatsApp message away at any hour of the day. A fitness freak. You don't come to know if she's ill when she's working. She's so energetic. Her presence always adds to the energy, vigor, and positivity in her vicinity. The entire session may fall short talking about you, Harini. Over to you. We can't wait more.
Thank you so much, Aditi. This was probably the longest introduction I've ever heard about myself. But if I have to put all of this in one word, and what is it that made me, all that you described, I think that one word is a student, okay? I don't call myself a learner. I call myself a student because I try to get into the depth and study subjects as I see around me. For me, learner is someone who would just learn along the way, but a student is someone who gets into the depth. So I want to go back a little in history and tell you where it all started. And I'm trying to put that into context because for me, Guru Purnima Special or GPS, the short form of Guru Purnima Special itself is GPS, and it's a beautiful way we put the ideas together. I've had very interesting experiences as a student in life. So I'll give you two very clear experiences which has made me what I am today. One is very, very early in my childhood, and one is very, very recent, as late as last year. Year 1978, as a four-year-old, when I went into school, I knew only one language. I could speak only my mother tongue. I could speak only Tamil. And I was put in an English medium school. My mother was a very, very well-known teacher in that school. And my first day at school, I was put into a class of 60-plus students. And I had no clue whom to talk to and how to talk to. Because the only language I knew was Tamil. And I knew to write English alphabets. I knew a little bit of arithmetic. I was taught, when I was about a year old, I was taught basics of reading, writing, but I didn't know conversational English. So sitting in a classroom with 60 plus students was intimidating for me. I was an extremely timid individual. I still am an introvert, which none of you will believe. And there are people who challenge me saying you cannot be an introvert, but my MBTI profile says that. I am an introvert, and I was very timid those days. And my knees would buckle the moment I would see 63 strangers in the class. To me, they didn't appear like peer level because I entered in a class not knowing what they're speaking. And therefore, whatever they spoke to me sounded like bullying. Eventually, it turned out to be a lot of bullying. Fortunately for me, I was told two things by my parents when I was admitted in school, and I had observed at home as well, is that school takes you on field trips where you learn a lot from observations in your surroundings. The second thing I was told at home and what I also observed is school has libraries. So the two things I was told about going to school, I was told about field trips where you learn from observing things around you, and I was told about the library. For some reason, my parents forgot to tell me that there will be 63 strangers in the class. So it is extremely intimidating, but the only thing I knew I had in my mind was, I have to get there to the library. I need to find out where this thing called library is. And on the first day in school, day one, kindergarten class, four-year-old, I asked my class teacher, when are you going to give us library books? I asked in Tamil. Fortunately, the teacher also was Tamil speaking, so it was easy for me to converse. And her name was Vasanti, by the way. So I asked her, when are you going to take us to the library? And when are you going to take us on a field trip? She almost had a heart attack. She said, never in my career of 30 years, I have seen a kindergarten child asking me these two questions on day one. The beauty is, she didn't punish me as, you know, calling me over smart. The beauty is, she got me into meaningful conversations. And she said, field trip will happen much later in the year. Before that, you've got to start making friends. And she told me, the classroom is your first field. Now let's sit and discuss what is it that you're observing around you and what are your learnings. I started studying the classroom. I wasn't sitting there observing, I was studying the classroom. I started studying people, I started studying their behavior, I started studying how certain background influences some behaviors. And I had a lot of learning by the time I finished 1 week in class. So this was one of my earliest experiences of being a student. Till that time, I might have been a learner as I was growing up at home. I didn't go to play school. I didn't go to, I just went attended one kindergarten class, and then I was in class one. So I did a lot of learning from around me. But once I went there, I figured out that I'm a student and I have to get into the depth and not scrape the surface. Another time and space in time where I was really a student was until last year, the start of the pandemic. I had somebody who was a caretaker in my house. I wouldn't call her caretaker. I wouldn't call her my maid. I wouldn't call her my cook. She was my lifeline. She brought up my children when they were very young. She practically spent almost the whole day with me. Sometimes stayed back even. I figured out that she was hardly literate, but the kind of upbringing she has given for my children is way beyond sophistication. She always wore a broad smile on her face. She would come in with a ringing voice. Her voice would reverberate in my entire house. I also realized that she has a lot of difficulties in her life. But when she is at work, she brings her entire self to work. And the way it changed, the way she delivered at work was phenomenal. I learned a lot from her, obviously, but I studied her behavior as well. And I studied why. And I figured out that she wasn't there because she wanted the money. Of course, that was, by the way. She wasn't here because she wanted a livelihood. She was here because she wanted to learn something new. Unfortunately, I lost her last year. She left the world. I thought she would never leave me, but she left the world. But she made me a lifelong student. Not a lifelong learner, but a lifelong student. Every time I find things bogging me down, I go back and I analyze her behavior over a period of 14 years that she was with me. And it gave me a huge meaning in trying to search for things to study and not just learn. So I come from a family of teachers. So for me, teaching, learning, and all that was things that were happening every day at home. My grandmother had only one thing to tell me, and she said that teachers will do their job. They will. But if you really have to get the most out of them, the intent has to come from within you as a student. I tried a lot of experiments on myself. There were times where I wasn't very interested in some subjects, and I would just let go, not pay attention, not ask questions, not get into discussions in the class, not be an active listener. And I realized that the learning was very superficial. I would get marks in the exam, okay? But if I were to get into a conversation with somebody, it never helped because I was not an active listener in the class. Then I figured out that I'm learning by observation, but I am not studying it if I'm not getting into depth. So when I wanted to, I had created a purpose for myself. I said, I can't make friends. I'm pretty much a loner. I'm an introvert, but I want to start understanding people. I want to start being with people, and what do I do? You know, because there's a lot of loneliness in a person like me who remains confined to books and studies and stuff like that. So then I figured out that the only way for me is to have conversations with people. And how do I have meaningful conversations? If I have superficial knowledge, meaningful conversations are not going to happen. I said, I need to get into depths of subjects. So I had this little book I used to carry with me always. It was a little handmade book. Okay, I used to fold a paper into 16. So any sheet of paper, it's scientifically proven, no matter what the size is, you can fold it only 16 times. Okay, test it. Pick a newspaper or take an A4 size sheet paper. You can fold it only, you can make only 16 folds. So I used to make it 16, and I used to make a 32 page booklet, and it was a constant companion. And that booklet used to be my reminder to study and not just learn. And how the booklet used to be my reminder is, I used to keep writing in it a list of things I wanted to study about and not just learn. And my purpose was to be able to have meaningful conversations. So my very early companions in my house, because we were just moving into a new home in Mumbai, and we were designing stuff and creating furniture. So my earliest companions at home were the carpenter Kaka. Okay, so we used to call him Carpenter Kaka. And my conversations with him used to be around aluminium, nails, and tools. So my booklet used to have things like, what is aluminium? What's its origin? How is it made? And, how are these blocks of wood, if they're coming from trees, why do they look so different? Why is it smooth? And why is it not like a tree trunk? And these were all questions which I would write in that book. There was no internet, there was no Google, but there were people around me with whom I used to have conversations asking these questions. So I would pick up a topic and ask as many questions as I can around those. Then I realized that there was a point of time where I was able to have meaningful conversations about several topics with several kinds of people. So whether the age group of the person I'm having a conversation is 6 years or 60 years, I had something to talk about. Because over a period of time, I had those little books which are equivalent to a Google search history today, where I had gone into some depth. The point I'm making is, who asked me to do this? Nobody. Did any teacher ask me to find out more, learn more, study more? No. My teachers only told me that there is a lot of knowledge around you. Whether you want to learn or you want to study, it's your choice. If you learn, it's a little comfortable and you can learn a lot of things at the same time. But if you're studying, every time you go into the depth of the subject and you find out roots and connections, you form a network of subjects in your mind. And that takes a lot of effort. So the choice was left to me, whether I need to take that effort or I need to learn as I observe. I obviously took the difficult route because my objective was to make friends. The only way to make friends was to have meaningful conversations. So I did that. And over a period of time, I figured out that there's a lot I could talk to with people. I could ask questions and I could ask meaningful questions. So a learning from this experience for me is that when you're talking about knowledge, myth number one is that your teacher or your guide or your mentor or your coach or your trainer tells you what to do. That's a myth. If you really want to get the maximum out of it, I think you have to be a seeker. Your teacher is there. Like you said, like a GPS system, the teacher is there. You say what's your destination is. The GPS will tell you that's the destination. This is the path. But as you navigate through that path, okay, it's up to you whether you want to navigate blindfolded, just follow the GPS directions and reach there. Or do you want to look at the scenery around you? And enjoy the ride so that you go back and you write a travelogue that I traveled this route on the left-hand side, I saw these waterfalls. On the right-hand side, I saw these, the depths and it was all green in the rains. And you become poetic and you have learned a lot more in that journey rather than just letting the GPS guide you. So we bring that analogy into the Guru Shishya Parampara. The Guru is a GPS. In all possible ways, and it almost pretty much the same way, because the guru knows what's your ultimate destination. The guru can even guide you to where your destination should be. The guru can tell you what is the path you take to get there. But what each one of us as a student needs to do is keep asking questions through that entire journey. We're talking so much of mentoring these days in the corporate world, right? And to me, mentoring is not a new concept at all. It's not something that has come from the Western management methods. Look at our Guru Shishya Parampara. Okay, so in the olden times, why students were sent to live in the Gurukul, it was a lot more than just the hostel. It was not just to stay away from home, but more than staying away from home, it was meant to stay with the Guru, with your GPS, so that you're able to get an experiential learning. So if you watch very carefully some of the mythological tales, if they are depicted well on the web series, or if you read those books, you actually might even figure out how staying with the guru lets a person experience holistically a lot of things other than just the subject, right? So the student sitting in a Gurukul will observe the guru, will observe how the guru responds to stimulus, will observe how the guru reacts to situations, will observe how the guru tackles emergencies. And all of these are things that people would study, the students would study, and they would carry back with them as experiences and as pieces of knowledge. Now, if you ask me, how is it going to be useful? If the guru is directly teaching you a subject of your choice, of course, it's going to be useful. But if the guru is not teaching you a subject of your choice, the experiential learning is actually subject agnostic. Now, there cannot be a better example than the various stunts I have done in the way I have navigated through my career. I started off very, very passionately into studying medicine via the pharmacy route. I was extremely passionate. I mean, I took the toughest way into my master's there. I wrote a thesis. I published 24 plus research papers in international journals. Not a very easy task. Did 18, 19 hours of work in the laboratory. I have around 4 or 5, compounds which I created, which have been patented. All of that. Later on, when I moved into HR, it was a tangential, absolute turn, and no one ever expected that I would make any sense in HR. And they all said that your learning and your research has gone to waste. In fact, my head of the department from Mumbai University still doesn't talk to me because he feels that I put that learning to waste. But if I look at myself today, I'm again on the path of research. I'm once again on my journey of writing papers in journals. I've started doing that. And, I'm eventually going to convert all my HR work into research papers so that it becomes valuable for someone else. Now, where did the analytical ability, the art of writing a research paper, the science of being able to observe, draw patterns, identify trends, come out with solutions, come out with working models, where did all that come from? It came from what I learned while being a scientist. So even if I have changed routes drastically, the way I observed my mentor in understanding a problem and narrowing down a solution, eliminating the wrong solutions, that has built some ability in me. So how did that happen? It was out of the curriculum. I would go and keep asking questions. Now, that is one aspect of it. Now, the second aspect of it is learning hierarchical? Do you always have to learn from somebody above you? Now, that question always intrigued me because we're increasingly talking of reverse mentoring. But if I look back at wherever I have evolved as a professional, I have learned something from someone. I have studied after the person gave me a direction. So, a lot of people would tell me that you should do this next. So I would take that as my direction in the GPS. I would take that as the navigation path, but I would go down and find out more and study more and put myself in a position to be able to have a conversation with my GPS saying that this is where I'm heading and then walk parallel. I'm putting in a lot of momentum into it and then we walk parallel. So it is a lot of effort which has to come from the learner in order to be a student. So my GPSs have not only been my parents, elders, teachers, guides, mentors, etc. I've had a bunch of millennials at different times in life. They've come and made huge impact to me. And I've picked up things from them and I've had conversations with them as if I'm one of them. So one thing is that it's not that the teacher or the guru or the mentor has to tell you what to do. They can definitely tell you what your destination could be. They can guide you towards your destination. They can give you the path, the best possible path. But how you make it enriching, how do you make that entire experience enriching is all up to yourself. So whether you want to be a learner or you want to be a student is your choice. So that's one. The second thing is, you can be a student of anybody. So I don't think that there's got age or hierarchy has got to do anything with being a student. You can be a student of anyone. But when if you have to be a student, you have to be able to, ask those relevant questions at the right time. And in the corporate world, what I did as a student was, I had a certain goal for myself. And what I did as a student was I used to follow people very, very closely, not just on social media. In fact, not on social media. I used to follow people and their behaviors, observe them. get into conversations with them, ask a lot of questions, see how they react to situations, how they respond to emails, how they build proposal documents, how they experiment in the workplace, what do they do with those experiments, how do they conduct themselves in meetings. A lot of it, and I would try and do a lot of caricaturing of people whom I follow. And that kind of learning from a mentor came a long way. All said and done, whether you're a student or a learner, all this while I've been telling about what is it that you can ask, you can pick up, and you can assimilate, internalize. But even that's not enough, if you actually see. Assimilation and internalization, we feel, arre bahut kuch ho gaya, isse zyada aur kya seekhenge? But if you really want to complete that learning, you have to be able to apply it. And if you're not applying, then that learning is really of not much meaning. And why this thing is very close to my heart is when we hear people talking, you know, in webinars like this, the whole of last year plus, we've been hearing a lot of talks. And after every, sometimes I listen into a lot of talks. I do watch a lot of YouTube videos where people have spoken on very interesting topics. And I always wonder that if we're able to give such inspiring talks, why is the workplace so boring? Why do people still complain that workplace is boring when there are so many friends who are able to give such inspirational talks? Curious, I had a bunch of interns who were willing to do live projects with me. So I asked them to find out more about this. And then I figured out that it's very easy to preach, but it's very difficult to practice, right? And when it's very difficult to practice, and when you try and preach, instead of only preaching, what if you preach all that you've practiced? What if all these inspirational talks are not purely inspirational, they're not philosophical, but they're practical? So when you apply what you're doing, and when you come back and share what you've already applied, and you bring out real success stories and talk about those success stories to people, to your audience, you're actually demonstrating a very big virtue. And that is, you know, application. And the entire learning becomes 100% meaningful after you have learned by observation, you have studied by experience, you have internalized by practice, and you have applied to perfection. So once you've gone through this entire navigation of these four stages, that's when your learning is complete. And it looks like a lot of effort, but believe me, if you are a seeker, now if you want to get to some place, come what may, right? Barish ho, baad ho, kuch bhi ho, agar hume ek jagah pahunchna hi hai, and you have your GPS ready, you know that the ride is not going to be smooth, but if you've made up your mind to get there, you get there. And I think it's as simple as that. Many a time, we keep a lot of these learning things slightly on the back burner because we feel knowledge is easy to get, you know, because we have internet tools, we have Google. So we feel that it's easy to get knowledge. So we keep a lot of studying for a rainy day. And we don't really get into that aspect. But imagine, look at it this way. Internet is free, almost free. Google is free, easily accessible on your handphones as well. Why don't you leverage on that and study instead of saying, you know, we will cross the bridge when it comes, right? So the moment you hear a new word, you hear a new concept, if you spend 15, 20 minutes that same day and do a deep dive into that subject, your assimilation and internalization of that concept becomes much better. Instead of saying, interesting concept, I will apply it some other time in the future. By the time you would have forgotten that concept. So quickly, if you start internalizing on the same day, you know, you start looking at the subject in depth, read, understand, you know, it stays with you like a golden nugget. There are lots of golden nuggets along the way. It's like that, what is that interesting phone game which my son keeps playing? That's this boy who keeps running And then there are those golden coins.
Templeton?
Yeah, not Templeton, there's another one similar to that. And there are those golden coins which he collects along the way. So it's like that, you know, it's you keep going without collecting those coins, you will still reach there. But it's about collecting them. So my simple submission to this is, I don't think we should hold any teacher, mentor, trainer, anyone responsible for how much we have gained. I think, first of all, the accountability lies within us. So how grounded you are, how you make yourself vulnerable, saying that, I don't know, tell me more. I'm a design thinker by heart, soul, whatever. So it's like that. So the moment you make yourself vulnerable and say that, I don't know, tell me more, you're motivating yourself to ask more questions. And that's the best way to learn. So I would never say that the learning is not good enough because the teacher was not good enough. I would say that if the learning is excellent, it's because of the student, because the student has studied the subject and also gone to the extent of application. And the teacher has been an excellent guide. So the teacher mentors are meant to be guides. They will have lots to share. Especially mentors are expected to go beyond the subject and talk about their life lessons. And mentees are supposed to understand from their life lessons and not just the subject. And you enrich it only by learning. So if you look at the two words, training and learning, it's pretty indicative of where accountability lies. When you say training, the accountability lies with the trainer. So training session mein, hum classroom mein so sakte, kyunki wo trainer ka kaam hai. Okay, so feedback hum trainer ko denge. कि आपका सेशन ठीक था या बेकार था, हमारा उसमें कोई अकाउंटेबिलिटी नहीं है. ओके, बट इफ यू आर अ लर्नर और इफ यू आर अ स्टूडेंट, हु डज द लर्निंग, नॉट द फैसिलिटेटर, इट्स द लर्नर हु डज द एक्शन ऑफ लर्निंग, इट्स द स्टूडेंट हु स्टडीज. सो इन दीज वर्ड्स, द अकाउंटेबिलिटी ऑफ इफेक्टिवनेस ऑफ दैट इंटरवेंशन ऑफ दैट सेशन इज विद द लर्नर और विद द स्टूडेंट. So what happens is, now when you're taking feedback of a session and you're saying that the trainer was good, not good, I would say try to measure effectiveness of the learning in whatever way. See whether application is happening meaningfully. See if the learner or a student is able to have a meaningful conversation on that subject. Test after a while whether there is retention of it. Follow that person and see if that person is making meaningful application of it in different contexts. A lot of these things will tell you how effective learning is. So with all due respect to trainers around me, I also do a lot of training sessions, but with all due respects to training, I would still say accountability of effectiveness does not lie with the guru alone, with the trainer or teacher or mentor alone. Lies with the recipient. So unless the recipient is willing, unless the will is high, no matter how much of skill you try and put it, you know, put into the brains, it won't happen. There won't be space for it unless the willingness is high. Now this reminds me of something that I read recently. It's a very well-known anecdote, but I love the beauty with which it was narrated. This is somewhere in the late 18th century. There was a Zen master in Japan, and the Zen master was known to teach with very little words. He would hardly speak, and there would be hardly any conversations. He would be in silence most of the time, but he was known as one of the world's best teachers, guides, whatever you may call it. So there was this very wealthy businessman who was also quite learned. He had gone to different universities, got a lot of, he had qualified himself in so many things, and he had built an empire with his business and earned a lot of money. And he challenged the Zen master and he said, look, you're sitting alone in that monastery and you're teaching in silence. Okay. I am running an institution here and I have got teachers who teach. I also teach. So the learning that we impart will be much higher than the learning that you impart. He said, let's challenge each other someday. So the Zen master said, okay, I'm open for the challenge, but we will do a very simple experiment. And I want to see, first I want to test you, whether you are a learner, you are a student yourself. Because if you are not a student, then God save your students. Okay? So he invites the businessman to his monastery. The businessman arrives there in the morning. It's tea time. The Zen master is silent. He doesn't speak. And this whole experiment is in silence. He doesn't speak. He says, it's tea time. So he offers him tea. And when the tea tray arrives, the Zen master picks up the kettle and starts pouring into tea into the cup, which is meant for the business. And he keeps on pouring. And the cup is filled to the brim. It's about to overflow. So the businessman says, stop. Can't you see it's overflowing? How much can you fill into this cup? So the Zen master says, this is precisely what I wanted to tell you. You have to first learn to empty your cup. When you empty your cup, you start building the willingness to learn. Only when you have the willingness to learn, you will be able to capture or absorb or assimilate what the master is telling you. So if you do not have the willingness to learn, how, my dear friend, will you teach this value, this virtue to your students, that you have to have the willingness to learn? So here is where I noticed that the willingness to learn is more important than just skill building. So if you have to grow, if you have to get enlightened, if you have to keep adding something day by day, you have to keep shedding something day by day. You have to create that space. And how do you create that space? Is by having meaningful conversations with people and sharing the wisdom that you've got. And I think I'm pretty much in that journey. So for me, this year's Guru Purnima is dedicated to somebody who has taught me how to live a meaningful life, how to wear a smile on your face, how to bring smiles to other people, and she was my caretaker. So this year's Guru Purnima for me is dedicated to her. Every year I find somebody whom I'm able to dedicate. So this one is for her, and she's been my big teacher in the last few years. So with that, I take a pause here and a sip of tea. And if we have any conversations that we can get out to, Aditi, that'll be great.
That was so insightful. Let me just see if we have a few questions. If people have a few questions to ask from whatever they heard till now. One thing before I go to the others' questions, what is your take on learn, unlearn, and relearn? I am really curious.
If you ask me, I have a very personal view on this. It might be contrary to a lot of popular opinion. For me, there is nothing called as unlearn and relearn. It's only learn. And learn is nothing but study. Okay? Mm-hmm. You go deeper. If you ask me why did I have to unlearn anything when I moved from pharma to HR? No, I didn't. I learned something there. I learned scientific methods. I learned data analysis. I learned statistical methods. I didn't unlearn anything. Yeah, I may not be applying my medicinal chemistry reactions and formulae in my workplace. I'm not applying, but I'm not unlearning anything. And there is no such thing as a relearn. Because I'm learning something new. Each time you're learning something which is a modified version or a better version of something else, you're learning it. You're learning the better version. So there's nothing called as a relearn. So there's learn. So three times learning is equal to study. So for me, it's getting into the depths.
All right. So that's really interesting to know that there's something unlearning for you. Whatever you've learned, you're definitely going to put to use.
Yeah, I don't have amnesia, so I'm not going to forget.
That's great. It was one thing which I noticed was a stark difference between learner and student. So before this session, I did not consciously pay attention to the difference that, okay, this is a student, this is a learner, and how helpful it is to be a student and not just be a learner.
I was actually just playing with the semantics of the words in English language, but yeah, but to me, when I get into semantics, it pushes me to, it actually conditions my mind to recognize that word with different emotions. So normally, even when I say, I don't say stakeholder management. I say stakeholder alignment. Because when you say manage, it means, theek hai, manage kar liya. But when you say align, it says that you're making a conscious effort to align. So similarly, when you say learn, you learn by observation. But when you say study, you study by experience, right? So how it again comes into a lot of these talks that we hear is when people convey a lot by what they have observed, you still can challenge some of them saying that your observations are great, but my situations are different. So what philosophy you're talking may not work for me. Okay, many times we hear these debates happening after these talks. But when someone speaks out of experience and shares experience, as a listener also, you get a feel that, oh, this person has actually tried it. So this person must have burnt his or her fingers. So when he or she says it works, it must be working for me also. So you get into your brain starts thinking and looking at the two words differently. So so learn and study. Study is a lot more in depth. So when you're studying something, you cannot unstudy. No, there's no such thing as unstudy. So why unlearn?
That's wonderful. That's brilliant. There's no antonym to studying. You can keep studying everything.
Exactly.
That's what
I say. So why would you unlearn? In fact, I don't think unlearn is a word in the English language dictionary. It's something, it's a management jargon which we have created. So, I'm a Puritan when it comes to languages. So it's not in the dictionary. Relearn is also not in the dictionary. So it's learn, it's study. There is no antonym.
Oh, wow. That's a new mantra that we take back. Yes. On Guru Purnima's special GPS session today. The other thing you were talking about was experiential learning. So you said even if the subject is not that interesting, but the experiential learning, kind of helps you to enrich yourselves. And even that is something that helps you learn. It's not that you go to the college, you're not liking the subject, you bunk the lecture, and you go to a cafe and you sit there. So can you tell me some difference which you feel in the education or the learning system right now versus what it used to be a 1,000 years back? How is it that the current learning system has evolved, and how do you feel it is helping us be a student?
This is very interesting. There has been it has been progressive in a way, I would say. Okay, I won't say that there is regression. Definitely there is progression. But what is happening is, because we have gotten into the comfort zone of knowledge being available to us very easily at the click of a button, the effort and the pursuit of knowledge is somewhere kind of slightly shaken. And where this actually this thought came to me is the other day I was clearing my cupboard, and I came across a bunch of school projects which I had made and my brother had made. Oh. 40 years ago, okay? Oh, not very recent. 40 years ago. So those school projects were actually hand-stitched paper, hand-drawn, hand-written. They were all manuscripts. And they were deep-rooted research. For example, it was critical appreciation of a poem by Keats, Byron, and Shelley. Okay, oh. So that was a class 9 project. And there was a Sanskrit project where the Love Kush story was drawn like a Namar Chitra Katha. So there were pictures with bubble dialogues and all of that. So my daughter was asking, this is a school project? I said, yeah, it's a school project. And I said, now, how much time would have gone in making that project? Was maybe 2 months, 2 hours a day for 2 months. Today, if I were to write a poetry appreciation of poems by Keats, Byron, and Shelley, take me 2 hours. I can copy paste.
Okay.
So I would have learned that each Byron and Shelley have composed these poems and there are similarities in these poems. I've learned. But does that learning stay with me? Or if I had studied it and written it, does it stay with me? So that's one thing. So if you look at evolution, the tools, the what do you say, the tools and whatever equipment you have with you, the enablers, the enablers for learning, there has been tremendous amount of progress. Information is available at the click of a button. Not just information now, because there's a lot of false information coming through WhatsApp University. You also have tools to validate it, right? So every problem is giving rise to a solution. So all of that, you have so many enablers. But with those enablers, what is happening is we are not exercising our brain cells enough. So while technology is progressing, somewhere our mindset is regressing, saying that, yeah, there's something which is easy. Let's take that easy way out. So constantly, while we are becoming knowledgeable, because we are not allowing time for that knowledge to soak in, we are not allowing time for knowledge to get internalized, we don't see chances for application of that knowledge, our learning is kind of regressing and it is coming at a, it's plateauing. Okay, so technology is going ahead, giving us enablers. But instead of using the enablers, we are getting into a comfort zone. So that is the gap that we need to bridge.
Excellent. So what do you think is a solution? Like how we as students, as young professionals, not only into HR, but in various fraternities, how can we make sure that the essence of learning, which was there in the earlier learning system, also remains? Plus, we can make use of these enablers as enablers, and not as mediums that can add to our comfort zone.
So very simple. I keep telling myself also that don't do things for tick in the box, right? So and let me not stick to HR. I'm making something very generic. So if you have to work on a project at work, HR project, engineering project, a particular lead you're chasing, you want to convert it to a client, whatever. Because technology is available, if we say that, okay, on the last day, I will do a Google search to find out about this particular lead, then I'll build my conversation around that. Then you're doing it like a tick in the box. Instead, if you say that I have to convert this lead to a client, okay, I have to make this happen. And no matter how much I do, the effort is not going to be enough. If you keep saying that to yourself, you automatically start getting uncomfortable and you start your research right away. So it's just that you have to tell yourself that we have to do it. On the one hand, you know, we also tell that it's okay to fail. But what I'm saying is deliberately letting yourself fail is a trap that we are falling into. We console ourselves that theek hai, it's okay to fail, but mehnat kiye bina fail theek nahi hota. So I think it's very consciously you have to put your effort. Do not do anything as a tick in the box. So if you want to apply your learning, whatever you studied in your B school, if you want to apply it at work, create opportunities for yourself. Don't wait for tasks to come to you. Find out if there are employee engagement challenges. Design something that you want to design. Whoever is a certified design thinker can look for projects around you and apply it. And nobody is stopping you from applying it. They may not buy your solution. That's their problem. But if you apply it, you become thorough at it. So if not any great advantage, it definitely builds a lot of meat into your resume. So if you're able to talk about what you did in a job interview and you're able to talk for 25 minutes, absolute authentic statements, say that these are areas where I goofed up, where I made blunders, and this is how I did things differently, you will still find yourself a lot more enriched. Yeah, but if you say that these were the tasks I did, I learned these tasks and I did them, I studied these concepts and I applied them, it's a world of a difference. But again, the choice is ours. So nothing stops us from applying it, except our own need to get into a comfort zone, except our own need to give in to a lot of, relaxation, entertainment, and all of that. If you don't give in to it, I think we don't have a choice but to study and just learn.
Wonderful, wonderful. That's really an eye opener, because many times you tend to fall into the trap that you're talking about. We go to Google, take something. So this is something that helps us enrich ourselves, and we feel more confident when we work over it. And then, Harina, I guess you're on mute?
No.
Okay. I just couldn't get you for the last few seconds. So, well, I was just talking with you, I just realized that when we work on it, we enrich ourselves and we have the confidence to even put forth your presentation, even put forth things which may not be a complete solution to the challenge that the organization is facing or a team is facing. But then you are very much confident about the work that you've done, and you're ready to take what comes to you. It may be a criticism, it may be an appreciation, whatever it is. But you work on it further by taking these inputs. So it's my takeaway from this. We have two more questions, Harini, for you. One is how you bypass various distractions while studying. That is by a viewer, Jalpa Kachara.
Okay, how do you bypass distractions? Do a very simple test. Ask yourself, what do I get by, let's assume distractions, one is social media and the other is, let's say, television. Okay, these are the two distractions that you have. Ask yourself two questions. What will I get if I spend so many hours on social media? What will I get if I spend so many hours by watching TV? What will I get if I spend so many hours working on a project I have in my mind? Look at the outcome. What is the outcome you will get at the end of this? You decide for yourself which outcome you want. If you want the outcome of only relaxation and, I just want to talk to people aimlessly, that's the outcome you want. Yeah, go ahead and do it. Be on social media. But if you want an outcome of having created something, then you will have to take that path. So the GPS will tell you that, yeah, there is. So if you, things around you, okay, you're asking your GPS, what are things around me? So the GPS will say, this is a route to go to the beach. This is the route to go to the bar. This is the route to go to the library. The GPS is not going to tell you where to go, where you should go, right? So your GPS will tell you, yes, sab hai. But what is it that you, do you want to get drunk? Do you want to swim today? Or do you want to learn and finish something? How do you make that choice? It's as easy as that. So even if the beach is attracting me, even if the bar is attracting me, if I know that I want to finish something today, I go to the library. So it's just that we allow things to distract us without looking at what is it that it is going to take us to. So just ask yourself this question. At the end of this 1 hour, what am I going to gain? Am I happy with what I'm going to gain? If I'm happy, take that path. So it's your choice.
We look forward. So we actually just analyze the thing that we'll be getting by doing it. That makes things.
Yes, that's the litmus test. What do I get at the end of this? Because see, anything that you do is time, right? And I would say that rather than spending time, each of us should invest our time. Anything that is spent is consumed. Anything that is invested fetches a return. So if you want to spend your time, the distractions are a plenty that helps you to spend your time. Your time gets consumed. Okay. But if you want to look at a return on investment, you have to invest your time. So where does this investment happen? Yeah, investment happens when you are trying to understand is the return kya hoga. So ask yourself, is the return kya hoga? You want to spend or you want to invest?
Lovely. That's so interesting. We have another question by Gayatri. She asks, when things are not aligned, then how can you take it further?
When things are not aligned, that's where you have these obstacles. But one is, very simple thing is, one is you have to have your goal fixed. So trust your GPS. The GPS will tell you that that's your destination. Until you get there, these obstacles are there. The GPS sometimes will tell you that there is a different path. Do you want to take that path? Make the choice. If the GPS tells you, quit this job, look for another job, this is not something that you're meant to be in. And if you trust your GPS, you will do that. Your GPS might tell you that there is a storm. So for a while, there's going to be nothing happening in your life. But relax, because tomorrow after the storm, you can continue on your journey. Trust your GPS. But if you start worrying that things are not coming my way, things are not getting aligned, you're actually, in a way, not trusting the GPS. So the GPS is not going to worry, right? But not trusting the GPS is going to give you a lot of stress. So if things are not aligned, work towards alternative routes to align things, or simply wait for the storm to pass. But fretting over it will bother you, will upset you, but the GPS is not going to worry.
Love it. Love it. That was so innate. And trusting the GPS, and when there's a storm, you just wait. If you feel like you need to quit. And that is also interesting. There are a lot of takeaways from this session, I find. I mean, and having you as a guest on Guru Purnima special, I mean, it's like dream come true for me.
It is definitely a pleasure for me to be talking to people who have been showering their love and affection on me and many others. I have no words to say how blessed I feel when people literally shower their blessings on me and shower their love and affection like the way all of you are doing. So absolutely, I'm speechless.
We always look up to you, Bharat. And we all love you. But there is one thing from Kishore Kumar Mukherjee, sir. He asked, shouldn't there be a mindset to study or a hunger to know? I guess that's what you mentioned.
Of course. All along my journey, that's precisely what I was saying, that the teacher will just guide. The skill can be imparted by the teacher, but if the willingness is not there, if you don't learn to empty your cup, if you don't learn to shed your ego that I know everything, baad mein dekh lenge, jab chahiye tabhi dhoond lenge. If you're not able to shed that, then that skill is just going to overflow. It's not going to enter your system and get assimilated at all. So that is precisely where I started saying that the teacher or the trainer will teach or train. Accountability is only to deliver it to you. But if you are a learner or a student, the accountability, the word itself says that you are a learner or you're a student, you're a seeker. You have to go seek. It's not just changing the mindset, but it is creating that fire in the belly, creating that hunger, saying that I want to get there. The need is whose? The need is the learners and the students. The need is not the teachers or the mentors, right? So if you want to get somewhere, you find your GPS, you find which destination you want to go to. The GPS will tell you which is the best way to get there. But the quality of that experience of that journey is yours. So it's absolutely, I agree with him. It is definitely the accountability of the learner or the student.
It was so wonderful to have you here, ma'am, on Guru Purnima special celebration of the GPS of Life session here. The thing that touched me was the assimilation, internalization and application mantra of yours, of today's thing, and the whole journey of accountability, of self-accountability that you took us through, that learning, studying, gaining knowledge, enriching is depending on the student or the learner himself or self. Students, teachers are there, mentors are there, they are there to give, but then we are supposed to receive it. Like, I would like to use an analogy here, analogy of the radio which we use. We need to tune into the specific frequency in order to listen to that particular song. So similarly, mentors are there, gurus are there to give, they are giving, but we need to develop that receptivity by tuning our frequency to whatever they are teaching and learning and gaining from them. This is what I learned from your session, ma'am. And constantly, there's no one who can stop you from learning. If you don't find any gurus around, you can always keep on moving ahead and the guru would find you. And this is the person who's here to learn. He or she is really on toes for learning. The guru would find you yourself. So you need not stop learning. Abhi koi mentor nahi mila hai, abhi coach nahi mila hai, to abhi nahi, abhi baad mein karte. Pehle coach dhoondte hai, phir aisa nahi.
And again, I always say mentoring is a two-way street. Okay. Mm-hmm. And believe me, anyone who says that I am a mentor is actually not really, is only walking halfway, not going the full way. Because what does a mentor gain in a mentoring program? Is the mentor also gains a lot from the mentee. So it is a mentor mentee, it's a relationship and it builds up gradually. So you cannot go and tell somebody that will you be my mentor. It is meaningless. It evolves over a period of time. It starts with building trust mutually. It goes both ways. It starts starts with having a lot of respect for each other. It starts with the willingness to share both sides, because as a mentee also you should be able to open up your windows of your brain and share openly, be vulnerable. The mentor should be willing to share his or her experiences. So it evolves. So when it evolves, it is a relationship, and any relationship has to be two ways. So it's not that mentor is somebody who only gives and the mentee is someone who only takes. If that is the feeling, then there's something fundamentally wrong. It becomes very stressful for the mentor. So it is a two-way street. It is a give and take both sides.
Oh, that was amazing for me, certainly. It was an amazing session with you, ma'am. There were a lot many things that we've learned. And of course, being a student is something which has, I would again repeat that being a student is something that has touched me always. That if someone asks you, what are you doing or what are you currently, what's a designation, then I feel I should always answer, student is my designation, student is what I am right now. I guess that will make me feel more happy and comfortable ever at every moment of my life. Thank you so much, Harini, for being here. It was lovely talking with you.
Pleasure is mine, and thanks everyone at HR Milestone for this wonderful GPS. and it was absolute pleasure to meet everybody today. Thank you so much.